Thank you very much. Good evening, everybody. Thank you for the presentation. I just would like to add that I have been working as neonatal doctor for 8 years of my life in low-income countries or war-torn countries, including Afghanistan, Cambodia, Sierra Leone, Central African Republic, Sudan, including Darfur, and Malawi. So I have an experience at village level, health center level, provincial hospital level and national level infrastructure. But before starting with my presentation, talking about advances of sex and reproductive rights, we cannot avoid to mention one of the main causes of maternal death worldwide, which is unsafe abortion. 70,000 women every year die because of unsafe abortion. We need laws at country level. 125 countries worldwide have abortion as illegal or highly restricted. And for my friend of Kuam, I just would like to comment that within the continuum of maternal and child project, there must be also the continuum of care include contraceptive, education and provision of services, which I'm not sure that Kuam provides. I hope there will be time in the discussion to go into details about it. So let's start from this picture. We are in rural Afghanistan. I've been working there 1 year of my life. Why it's important, these pictures? These colleagues, nurses, they are earning much more money than their husbands. They are respected in the society. They are self-efficient. They overcome all the social problems. This is about women empowerment. Also, it is important, this picture, because in that hospital, we have 7,000 deliveries per year, 9% only of cesarean sections, because we manage great multiparas. So before cutting an uterus, you think twice. Maternal mortality is almost zero. Neonatal mortality is acceptable. So if you offer free of charge good quality services, a lot of people come and cultural barriers drop down. So over there, we offer all modern contraceptive methods, including tubal ligation. But as it is free of charge and good quality, and the hospital staff are nice with the people, also the wife of the mullah comes for antenatal care and checkup. So I am a medical doctor, and it happens now that I am a politician. And this sentence makes sense for me. Politics is not, medicine is a social science, and politics is nothing but medicine on a larger scale. I want to start discussing with a congresswoman from the United States, Ocasio-Cortez. She wondered if our planet is going to hit a disaster if we don't turn this ship around. And she asked, is it okay to still have children? In my opinion, the question is useful, but is not correct. If we ask about population, demography, and environment, we must start from evidence-based data. So this is the UN projection of world population in 2100. We can be 16 billions, 10 billions, or 7 billions. It is up to us. This is the total fertility rate by country. And as you see, Afghanistan and Africa, part of Africa, are places nowadays with a very high total fertility rate. What does it mean? There is, of course, a relationship between total fertility rate and contraceptive prevalence rate. These are scientific data nobody can deny. This is very interesting, in my opinion, is total fertility rate and contraceptive prevalence rate with three experience, country experience, Malawi and Nigeria, Malawi and Ethiopia that are doing good, Ethiopia extremely good, and Niger is a little bit back. I want to try to make a move. As you see, year by year, the contraceptive use of Ethiopia and Rwanda increase, and the total fertility rate decreases, while Niger is a little bit stuck. So for sure, when the contraceptive is very low, less than 10%, the total fertility rate is above 7, on average, children per woman. And we still have many countries like that. When contraceptive rate is very high, more than 70 or 80, we have a total fertility rate around or below 2. In the middle, it's a little bit debatable because, for instance, fertility rate started to decline in Europe before contraception. So this tells us that contraception is not the only way to reduce fertility, but there are other factors that we have to study, analyze. So simply providing contraception will not reduce the total fertility rate. We need community participation, alignment, and we need to reduce the cost to access it. I just want to remember that the role of contraceptive must be voluntary, and it is to enable couples to achieve the desired number, the desired family size, not the number of the children that we think they should have. So it's about children, yes or no, when, how many, and the spacing between them. And it's a human right. This is a relationship between the contraceptive prevalence rate and maternal deaths. The more a population is familiar with contraceptive, the more maternal mortality rate drops. And it is the same with the neonatal deaths. Again, the example of Rwanda and Ethiopia tells us, and these are data. So I talked about numbers. We need to learn to see the statistics in the patient or in the person, and the person in the statistics. On the left side, you see a public document of the United Republic of Tanzania, who decided to stop a broadcasting of a radio transmission by a very good English NGO because they were using this radio transmission like a soap opera to tell people about, to get people familiar with the contraception. So, to go back to the question of the USA Congresswoman, this is a very crucial number. 214 million women in low-income regions have unmet need for family planning. It means they are pregnant. They didn't want to become pregnant. They knew about family planning, so at least for this huge number, it's not an issue of education. When they are interviewed, they say it was too expensive or the service was too far from home. Then I will just go quickly, dropping the fact that family planning is a human right, as it is stated in several and also very old political declarations. I just want to remind that within the definition of family planning, there is also infertility. So the treatment of infertility, which is also a big problem, is implicit in the idea of family planning. And I know for the position of the woman in many countries in the society, not to have a child when it's not a choice is a big problem. So the treatment of infertility is implicit in the definition of family planning. Thank you. I am going to end remembering the role of family planning in the Sustainable Development Goals. And for those of you that are Ethiopian, you should be really proud of being Ethiopian nowadays, because you are leading African countries together with Rwanda. These are numbers. In 2000, you had a contraceptive prevalence rate of 8.2%. Now it's 35.9%. Reducing the total fertility rate and the maternal mortality in your country. And we know also how to do it. So, the cost of all the modern contraceptive methods have been reduced in these two countries. But even more important, the most useful contraceptive, which are the long-lasting reversible contraceptive methods, could be given to women and patients just by medical doctors. In Ethiopia, and in Rwanda, and in Malawi, and in Ghana, has been done a great task shifting. Nurses were trained. So this procedure now, it's also in the end of the nurses. And as of you, all of you know, nurses are at health center level, very close to the house of the poorest, while medical doctors are only at hospital level, very far. So breaking down the financial barrier and breaking down the distance barrier can help all women to voluntarily assess sexual and reproductive health, include contraceptive. I will not talk about the demographic dividend. African Union worked a lot on these determinants. And I just want to say, as a small politician of the regional council, what I briefly did to say that it is possible to do, I wrote a resolution. It has been sent, Leonardo Monaco was helping me on this. It has been sent to the Federal Congress of the European Liberal Parties and was approved. So all the liberal parties in Europe now, they have adopted this resolution. This I will skip. This I will, and then at my local level, even if my region is managed by a far-right coalition, so I am in the opposition, I was able to get approved the funding of 1 million euro for the purchase of long-lasting family planning methods through UNFPA for African countries. So we must speak, but at every level we can try to be concrete. I just want to end you with this. I don't like very much this story. I think it's a little bit racist. You don't give a fish to a man. You teach him how to catch the fish. But I think we have to add one part of this story, which is very important. Eventually, in the end, who is eating the fish? Thank you very much for your attention, and thank you to my family.